Peace, peace, peace. And welcome back to Choppin It Up with the Conduit, Season 4, Episode 10. And this is our season finale. And tonight's special guest is pioneer and legend, pro skateboarder Steve Steadham. All thanks to my tribe, my executive producer Mika Sunga, you're the best. Graphics and promo, Mad Urgency Myron. And on video, Mecha Godzilla. Salutes to D-King and Bink the Monster for our intro. A huge thank you to our family and sponsors, Grown Fresh NYC, Street Fatigues, So What's the Scenario, and you can find them on our website at choppingituppodcast.com. We are on all streaming platforms, audio and visual, SoundCloud, Audio Mac, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and Podcasts on Vivo for your visual pleasure. Peace to everybody who joined the chat. Tonight's interview is a very special one to me. I've been an avid skateboarder for 30 plus years, and my first introduction into skateboarding was, you know, through a couple of friends of mine in my childhood. But to actually see somebody, you know, of the same hue, you know, in that time period, which was late 80s, early 90s, this guest of ours, Mr. Steve Steadham, was one of the first people that I actually got to see who was in his sport. And, you know, circling around 30 years later, this pioneer and legend will be a guest tonight on Choppin' It Up with the Conduit. You know, you see the sport, how it is, basically how it's changed over the past 30 years. At least I've seen it, because when it first started, or well, at least when I first started out, it was a, you know, totally white-dominated sport. And, you know, in my opinion, if it wasn't for pioneers such as Steve Steadham, you know, we wouldn't have the Sean Sheffies of the world. We wouldn't have the Stevie Williams, the Clyde Singletons, the Chuck Treeses, the Nigel Houstons, the Harold Hunters. I mean, I can go on and on and on. Like, you know, this man's a pioneer, and he definitely, in my opinion, you know, deserves his flowers. And I'm excited that he's going to be joining us tonight as our final guest for Choppin' It Up with the Conduit. Yes, I have Steve Steadham, former member of the Bones Brigade, with the likes of Tony Hawk, Lance Mountain, Mike MCGILL, Steve Caballero, Rodney Mullen. I mean, these are Hall of Fame riders, man, to a sport that has, you know, been through some extremes where at one point, you know, people thought skateboarding has died. And, you know, thanks to the innovation of street skating, it literally has brought everything back, you know, full circle. And, you know, to have Steve on tonight, you know, yeah, that's right. Godfathers. You're exactly right. And, you know, to have him on the show tonight, you know, to get to interview him is definitely an honor and a pleasure. So, you know, I thank y'all for tapping in. You know what I'm saying? You know, even if this is something that you're not into, or, you know, you might see it, but a lot of people, you know, would say that skateboarding and hip hop are, you know, coincide with each other, you know, because of, you know, the artistry and also the rebellion of things, which how you express your art. And what I mean by that, of course, you know, through your raps, but there's a way you express your art through your skating, through your style. And so, you know, it's a sport that I've grown to love. It's still in my blood. And for me, at 49 years old, I still, you know, get out there when I can and hit parks when I can. So I'm not doing crazy stuff like jumping down steps and stuff, you know. You know, kick flips here and there, a couple 50-50s, but you give me a mini ramp, I'm good to go. You know, that's really like my forte. So, You know, I come from the schools of the band This and Propaganda and Future Primitive and, you know, Animal Chin. You know, that was my childhood. That's what I was exposed to. And, you know, at that time, it was a rarity to see, you know, black kids on skateboards. You know, it was literally a rarity. And now you see the sport now and how it's being dominated by, of course, our hue right now. And this is just an honor and a pleasure. So let me check if he's definitely in the room. Peace to everybody checking in. Let me see what's good, okay? Give me a hot sec. Mr. Steadham.
What's up, man?
Thank you so much for joining us tonight.
You're so welcome.
Oh, wow. Well, I want if it's proper, I'd like to give the proper introduction. And the reason why I wanted to do this podcast tonight.
Can you hear me?
Ready? Yeah, I can hear you. You good?
Okay.
All right, good. All right. From Vegas to LA, this pioneer's journey in skateboarding has persevered with natural creativity and talent. He's continued to make his mark in the world through revolutionary music, television, and skateboarding. He was signed to one of the greatest companies in the history of the sport with POWELL PERALTA and becoming a member of the revered Bones Brigade with the likes of Tony Hawk, Steve Caballero, Rodney Mullen, et cetera, but then breaking off into his own with Steadham Skates, SGIs. I'd like to, for everybody to please welcome pioneer and legend, musician, artist, all of the above, Mr. Steve Steadham.
Well, thank you for the kind intro.
No, man, I had to do this because you were very influential coming up in my childhood, and that's what I wanted to explain to the people out here to give them a little personal aspect of why I wanted to do this interview. I've been skating for roughly over 30-plus years as well, and you know, my introduction into seeing another skater of, you know, my hue, of my color, was seeing you in the Bones Brigade video show, where you were skating with Tony Hawk. I assume, was that Delmarva?
Delmar, yep.
Yeah, Delmar. So, you know, just being able to see you at that time in, I would say, the late, you know, mid to late 80s, going into the 90s, you know, we weren't prevalent in the sport. I didn't get to see it that much. But seeing you, in my opinion, sparked, you know, the Sean Sheffies and the Stevie Williams and, you know, the Nigel Houstons and the Clyde Singletons, so on and so forth, of the world. Because I'm sure if they didn't, you know, even Ray Barbie as well, if they didn't see you, you know, I'm not sure where we would be in the sport today. So, you know, that's in my honest opinion.
It was a very different time back then, but yeah.
Yeah, so coming up in the late 70s and early 80s, you know, what was it that attracted you to skateboarding?
I don't know. I was a wrestler in high school, and then my friend was riding a skateboard around my neighborhood doing 360s, and then I went and saw some pool skating at the Dust Bowl in Vegas, and once I seen pool skating, that pretty much just mesmerized me, and then that was it. I knew I wanted to skate pools. That was all that happened. I just saw some guys skating in this big old pool here in Vegas.
So what was, like, the local scene growing up?
Well, I sort of was, there was a lot of bank slalom and stuff like that. It wasn't really, all the competitive stuff was out in California, but out here it was a smaller scene. But we skated pools. We had quite a few backyard pools, shotgun, desert surf. But it was very small. I had to travel to California to really go and skate with the good guys and see the pro contests and stuff.
Well, if it's okay, I want to tell, actually, you know, you said the one spot, shotgun. You want to tell the story behind the reason why they called this certain skate spot shotgun?
There was a guy named Rocky who owned the trailer park, and we jumped the fence and we're like cleaning out his pool, and he came out with a shotgun. We thought he was going to shoot us. And he was like, so nice. And then he was like, oh, you want to skateboard? And then after we talked to him, he let us come there and skate anytime we wanted for like a while.
That's awesome.
That was pretty cool.
How did your family, you know, take your involvement in skating?
They were really supportive of me throughout my being a teenager. My father, he always gave me the money to take the bus out to California and skateboard and stuff, but they were always supportive. They never said anything about why or, you know, why are you doing that? They were just like, whatever I was into, they were just like supportive. So that was a blessing, you know, and stuff. And I got more into skating, and he's like, go out to California, see what you can do. And I was like, kept going out to California to skate.
Wow, so it was really your family structure that gave you the support to pursue the sport?
Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
Were you ever deterred by, you know, any of your friends who thought of the sport in a negative way?
No, out here it was a really cool scene. All my friends that did skate, it was a tight, you know, little scene. Everyone supported each other. There was a lot of stuff going on. I didn't pick up on it really. A lot of people were just surprised, like, what are you guys doing? But it was more about skating in a pool. I don't think it was as much about a color thing. But skating was so underground then, you know? So it's come a long way.
So, I mean, it sounds like it was a little bit more progressive out west, because I know back east, you know, where when I started skating, like I said, it wasn't a lot of representation. The closest representation, you know, besides me seeing you on, you know, that Bones Brigade video show was another mentor and friend of mine, Mr. Sean Sheffy. So, you know, that was only the instances that I got to see it. And, you know, if we were seen on our boards, they were always asking us, well, why are you skating, or why are you basically participating in a quote unquote white sport? So like, that's kind of the kind of hardships that I had to go through in order to kind of prove myself. So I was kind of wondering if that was something that you ever had to go through, but you saying that your friends and your family were very supportive. So I guess it was definitely different cultures on different coasts.
I think it was more drastic in California, I think. The scene out here was only like a handful of us. So we didn't really care. You know, I mean, no one was just like, oh, you're black or anything like that. But going to California was more where I seemed more diverse. It wasn't as diverse. And a lot of people looked at me like, well, what are you doing here? And like, you know, shouldn't you be playing basketball or something? I was just like, wow. But I think people have grown a lot, even though there's a lot of racism and stereotyping, I think, even still to this day. I mean,
yes.
But it was cool, though, I think. It was cool being, I never looked at myself as being black, a black skater.
Right.
Most of my black friends, they looked at me like I was crazy, you know, and I talked with proper English, so they're like, oh, man, you sound like a white boy. Oh, and you skateboard? Oh, hell no. You know,
right. Oh,
you lost your mind. And I'm like, well, I'm not going to no snow. You know, so they look at me like, what? So my parents never told me about intellect or how to talk. I just, when I read books, I just enunciate everything, and I wanted to just speak with proper English.
Right.
But my culture took it as like, you're selling out to the white man, you know. So I had more slack from my own race, I should say, than other races, you know. All the guys in the Bones Brigade, they accepted me. I smoke weed, so they were a little like, wow, you're high as a kite, skate as good as us. Like, they looked at me like, this craziness. But I never felt anything with color with any of them. Lance and stuff, it was just so awesome. The whole team was just the best experience. They're all so humble and down to earth, and still like that.
Wow, man, like, it's so refreshing to hear, you know, you tell that story, because like I said, I went through that with, you know, my friends as well, because they looked at me like I was crazy. But I think they got to understand after a while, like, okay, he's good at this. And this is something that he loved. Okay, maybe we'll stop, you know, ridiculing him after a while. So that was just awesome to hear. That literally warms my heart. So if you don't mind me asking, like, who were some of your favorite skaters that influenced you the most and why?
My favorite skaters really was Brad Bowman. He totally, like, inspired me. But then it was, like, Steve Alba and then the whole Bones Brigade. Steve Caballero was, like, the epitome of the next level. Like, he wasn't even real.
Wow.
Yeah, he wasn't even a human and stuff. But the whole Bones Brigade, I was a Bones Brigade guy in the
Sims. Yeah.
So Dave Andrecht, I skated with him out in Whittier. Just me and him when I was just an amateur. He was so nice that it just sort of tripped me out because he just skated with me like he didn't even know me, but he was just like, hey, what's up? And he was out there busting board slides and stuff, and I was just ready to stop, take my pads off to watch.
Right.
And, you know, he's just like, no, come and skate, you know, and stuff. So I would say Brad Bowman, Caballero, Mike MCGILL, Lance Mallett, one of the best skaters ever.
Yes, Lance
Mallett. I was with Lance, so I skated with him a lot. That's really where I advanced a lot, being around the Whittier guys. Neil Blender.
All legends, man.
Oh, Neil Blender. He was cool, man.
Oh, my goodness, man. I'm literally reliving my childhood right now. Okay, let me ask you.
But I will say, though, that you were saying, Marty Grimes was a skater that when I went out to skate California at Oxnard a long time ago, I met the Z team with Jay Adams and Shogo Kubo and Marty Grimes and Polar Bear. And I think that's what changed my trajectory in skating, because when I skated them with them, well, I was watching them, I wasn't skating with them, but they were so nice and they just like made me feel like I was like one of them, and I never even met them. Jay Adams was so cool.
Oh man, hold on.
That's really what inspired me to.
This
really
is the Dogtown crew you're speaking of, correct?
Yeah.
All right. Let me stop for a second. For the people who do not understand, like, I need you to do your history if you can. You know, Google Dogtown, the Z Boys, the Venice skate scene. These guys were so instrumental to the sport. Oh, and you were like literally like rolling with these guys?
No, I was at the Oxnard skate park skating, visiting out there from Vegas, and they were there skating, and I was just like looking at them like, wow, man, some movie stars.
Yeah.
They just talked to me like I was just like, I know him for 10 years. It tripped me out, I ain't gonna lie. They were so nice that it just made me feel like I could be part of something, because they just were so welcoming. And Marty Grimes was so underrated. That guy was, he was just so good. And yeah, I didn't really think about it. I had got inspired by them before anything, really.
Mm-hmm.
And then it was after I went to the contest that Caballero, that next generation, was more, inspired me. But the Z team, I think, now I think about it, was really the beginning of wanting to be involved in skateboarding, like, for reals. You know, wow. Like, I feel like I could be part of something, because they just made me feel like I was part of the family. And I didn't even part know them.
Yeah, that's awesome, man.
So that wow.
So, do you ever still, talk to these guys? Do you ever get to run into them anytime?
Yeah, all the Bones Brigade guys, Lance Mountain, Christian, I see him often. Not often, but, you know, I go out and skate in California a lot. Mike MCGILL, Caballero, I see him every once in a while. I've been skating with a lot of the new kids throughout the last 7 years at the Comedy Pool and Vans and Orange.
Yes.
And Kiko and all the new generation guys. I'd be out there skating with these kids. I seen them skating when they were like little, like 5 years in a row I've been skating with them, and then every time I go out there and skate, they get so good, and now they're like the top generation. You know, Tom Char is the epitome of a professional skateboarder. You know what I mean? Nice guy, humble.
Yes.
He'll sit there skating with him, and he'll like, He won't even snake you or nothing. He'll look at you like, well, you're going to go. You're almost like, dude, you're Tom Shar. Really? Yeah. I mean, but I've been skating with them since they were little, and now they're, like, taller than me now. Like, all of them. It's crazy. But they're super nice.
Well, let's double back real quick, because I want to talk about your journey. Like, how did you end up being signed by one of the greatest skate companies in the world at that time in Powell Peralta?
I don't know. I think that God had some good plans for me, because I never, when I went up to see skateboard contests, I was like, there's no way I'm ever going to get that good. Like, you go see a contest in person, it's different than seeing a magazine or a video, you know, when you're standing next to the pool, when you're seeing the level. But I was an amateur skater that skated everything, freestyle, bank slalom, tight slalom, pool, ramp, vert, well, whatever the contest, I just skated. And I was at Upland Comedy Pool, and then Stacy and some of the Bones Brigade guys were there, and then someone's like, oh, they're looking at you to get you on the team. And I thought he was full of crap. You know, I like, you start, I go, stop messing with me, you're so dumb. You know what I mean? I was like, yeah, right. And then Stacy came over to me and he's like, yeah, so we've been, you know, checking you out, and, you know, we want you to be on the team. And I was still waiting for them to start laughing at me, like, you know, like, you dumb, like, you know, like, it wasn't even real. And it turned out to be real. And they were just like, very sincere, and I, that's how I got picked up on the team. And then it was real when I got my first box from Powell, and it was a box of, like, I talked to the team manager, he's like, well, what do you want? And I'm like, wow. I don't know, what can I get? And I'm like, I don't know what you want. And I was like, I didn't understand what he meant, like, what do you want? And I'm like, so if I wanted 10 boards and 20 t-shirts and, you know, whatever, like, I never experienced that. But he's like, whatever you want. So when the UPS truck came and bought these big boxes, oh my lord, that was, that's when I was really on the team, because at first I still didn't feel it was real. But that's how I got picked up by the Powell team. It was so fast, you know, like I never even talked to Stacy. I bought a board from him in the parking lot at Upland like a year.
Really?
Yeah, I came and just moved out. I graduated from high school, and then I moved out to California the next weekend, and moved in with Freddie DeSoto, who was another pro skater, a black skater. Very inspirational, nice guy. You know, Freddie is a super nice person. Always been a super nice person. Clean and just always positive. I moved out there with him just to skateboard, because I never was going to be good. You know, I was like, there's no way I'm going to skate as good as those guys. And then a few years later, I just skated with, I moved in Whittier. And we became a manager there and skated with Lance and Neil.
Yes, yes.
He was probably one of the most underrated skaters ever.
Yes, big time.
I mean, he's like, learn any trick. Every trick is just crazy. And I skated with Gator, too.
But hold on. Mark Gator Rogowski?
Yeah. I was really good friends with him. Like, you know, I knew him. Like, we go to a contest when we were amateur, and we didn't get money from our sponsors. We were staying in our car on someone's couch. And I knew him. I thought I knew him pretty close. He was, like, super nice. I mean, when I heard the stuff that he did, I was just like, there's no way that he did that.
Yeah, that was unfortunate.
But, you know, he turned himself in. You know, I mean, I have three daughters. I'm more like, I'm, you know, hypocrite, because I would have choked him to death, you know.
Yeah, I feel you.
Little girl, but, and not to get into that, because that's a,
yeah, no doubt,
dark thing, but he was so not like that. But I was inspired by all those guys. Whittier was a big turning point, because I was an amateur, and I became a manager. And then that's when they're all like, I wouldn't skate with all the good guys. I would sort of take my path and watch. And they're like, dude, what are you doing? Like, Lance and Neil, they're like, will you, like, really come and skate? And then I just started skating with them, and then I became their friends. And they became my friends, really. They, like the Z-Team, they almost, like, brought me in. Like, dude, come on and skate. You dumb? And then 2 years later, I was doing 5-6-foot airs in the bowl, because I picked up on the frequency from them. Like, they're all like, if you know, I wasn't going to leave once I became their friends. I'm like, wow, you guys are really nice, you know. And then I became part of the whole Whittier thing. And then that's really where my mind just, it shifted to the frequency of California, where if you're around the best skaters and you just want to have fun, you're going to get good. Because I never thought, honestly, I was never going to be a pro. Like, it wasn't possible.
You said God had a plan.
He had planned way beyond my imagination, because, boy, I couldn't believe it.
So, I mean, let's talk about the legendary Bones Brigade, you know, because, like I said, I my first inkling of y'all was, you know, the Bones Brigade video show to Future Primitive, you know what I mean? Then to, you know, the hype up for the search for Animal Chin, like just, you know, all of that stuff. I know that was after, you know, after you, but just being there in the beginning. So you're, you know, you're on a team with Tony Hawk, Steve Caballero, you know, Mike MCGILL, Lance Mountain, you know, Rodney Mullen. Like, did you ever think that in the beginning of your career, you know, you would be part of such a legendary team?
Wasn't possible. Like I said, for real, it wasn't possible. I went out to skate the up in contest and saw Caballero doing Caballeros in the combi pool. That was so above anything that I was just like, I can't even comprehend even. I mean, you know what I mean? It's like, it wasn't even possible. Honestly, when I saw them skating, I was like, man, I guess I'm never going to be a pro. I'm going to just, I moved out there just to be part of the scene while I was young. I was going to go be a lawyer, like, believe it or not. Like,
oh, really?
I decided to skate because I go, you can't get your youth back. I can always go to school, but I can never get, you know, and that's why I just graduated and moved out to California thinking there was no, it'd be like a couple years of that, get a job, and then that was it. And next 3 years later, I was on the Bones Brigade. So God is good, you know. I mean, I'm not perfect, but a lot of people, he gives me a lot of things. Now I understand my position in the sport, I guess, you know. Yeah. It was sort of someone else for so long, you know, until I realized, like, I got a pro model, what the hell, you know. You know, but, yeah.
Yeah, that's literally all, my mind is literally going crazy right now because of, you know, all these names that you just mentioned, you know, who are, you know, Hall of Fame guys, you know, legends who've created, you know, tricks that stand the test of time. And, you know, you've been around these guys and, you know, you were part of the innovation, you know, of the sport. Like I said, you're a pioneer in this thing, which also wants me to, you know, segue into, you know, some other things. You know, what made you leave, you know, the Bones Brigade?
Well, it was sort of I was selling a lot of boards and stuff, and I was always getting letters from George saying I was the number one selling board. So it didn't really matter. I wasn't any better than anyone else. But then the whole team came back from Puerto Rico or something. That's what I remember. And they were just like, where were you? Why were you at? They told us you were too busy working. I worked for Uncle Wiggly's Skateboard for like $8 an hour. Even when I was pro, I still had a job because I wasn't like, none of us were rock stars in our own minds. We're just like skaters skating. And then like, wow, we got a check for $5,000. That's crazy. You know, like, and then they were like, where were you at? They said you were too busy working. So they sent them, the whole Bones Brigade to Puerto Rico without me.
Wow.
And I really realized that. I'm like, what? They told me, they told the team that I was working. Like, I'm going to work for $8 an hour instead of going with my peers and my team that I was part of. And I think it just sort of crushed my spirit with that. And I didn't have anyone to talk to about it. I just felt like I just got cheated by my girlfriend or something. You know, like how could they do that and tell them I was busy working. I didn't even know they went to Puerto Rico. So then I just thought that, you know, I'm probably just, I had to leave even though I probably shouldn't have, you know. No. I talked to Stacy and then, you know, and everything, you know, he just, things happen, business, you know, people make decisions. But I think that what got me is the whole team went except for me. Yeah. So then I started thinking, like, well, this is a black thing. And then, because I just, like, I kept trying to go around and go, and I always came back to that. I just felt so alienated because wow. How could the whole team go except for me? And I was the number one selling board on the team, you know, which was a lot of boards. I mean, they're making a lot of money.
Right.
You know, I wasn't chasing money, but I just felt like, well, am I not worth a $300 ticket to Puerto Rico? You know? Making, you know, $50,000 a month off my boards, you know.
Right, off your boards. They're making money off your name.
You know, but I probably should have stayed on the team for, you know, because I just think it's something that happened. I don't really want to say it was intentional. But it's just a weird thing, you know. Like, I kept just wanting to think it was something else, but then I just sort of went back to that because I'm like, well, would it be? I mean, why would the whole team go except for me? You know what I mean? Like,
right, everyone right.
except for me. And then they're like, where were you at? I'm like, what are you talking about? They're like, we went to Puerto Rico, and they said you were working. I never talked to anyone about working. Because, of course, I would have went to Puerto Rico with those guys. You know, so, but like I said, the journey that God had for me, that was part of it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I became from writing for them to starting a company with SVI with my own name.
Yes.
Which I feel like, which is the journey that was part of what was supposed to happen. It was the hardest decision ever to tell Stacy that I was actually not going to be on the team.
Was that, if you don't mind me, if you don't mind me asking, because, you know, I see, you know, just in talking about that, it's kind of still a little bit, I would say, touchy. Was that something that was ever, you know, resolved, you know, later in y'all lives? Was, or just
we never talked just... about it. That's the thing. Like, when I just, after like time went by and I just, it kept just, I just felt like I wasn't part of the team. Like, that's really what did it for me. I'm like, wait a minute. You're selling my board. I'm on the team. I've been traveling with them everywhere. And then you send them like a you know, just appreciation trip type of thing.
Yeah.
And they didn't send me. I just felt like, well, I guess I'm not part of the team or something. That's pretty much how I took it, you know. Because if you're going to send everyone except for me, like, obviously I'm not strong enough part of the team to consider me that level. And I think that was really why I just had to move on, even though it sucked going to contests after that. Because I was always used to traveling with, you know, I would fly with Tony Hawk usually from San Diego because I lived in San Diego. And then we'd meet up with the other guys wherever we were going.
And right. We'd stay
in the together. So I hated going to contests after that. I'm not going to lie. It was the worst after I wasn't on the team anymore for me. Even though I've had my full ads and became a brand, I hated going to contests after that. And then going from a top 5 skater to like a top 20 in a year. It happened that fast, you know, because I just didn't even want to go to contests anymore. It was just weird. I see Caballero and McGill, and they're like, hey, what's up? You know what I mean? It's just sort of like...
They're super nonchalant about it.
Yeah, because they felt like I left them. Like, that's the spirit they had in their eyes. Like, you know, because we were like the Bones Brigade. Like, I, you know...
Right.
And I think I just hated going to a contest and seeing them without going with them, literally. And then I just lost interest in the street skating came. And the little tiny wheels and big old baggy pants, and I was just done because I like big things and speed and hot, you know. And then street skating was like, wow.
Right.
Now I appreciate it and respect it, but at that time, all it was big old ramps and big pools and stuff. And McGill made a 540, and that was insane. So seeing some guy do a tray flip on the street was like, you know, I wasn't driven. And then I quit skating for 15 years and played drums and went, man, and traveled all over the country. And
yeah.
So.
Well, let's you know, let's keep it moving on a good note, because, you know, I want to keep, you know, schooling, you know, our viewers, because, you know, you're definitely a you know, a pioneer in a lot of things, you know.
I don't even take a lot of that stuff. It might sound sort of dark. It was such a positive journey when I look back. Like, that was what was supposed to happen. So it's not a bad thing, but, you know, it sounds right. Like. I didn't want to skate, but I became a brand with my own name, and that was
different
than being one rider on a team. So it was really huge, but just the energy of skating. So it really wasn't like building a building and you're just like burned out from building the building. That's how I felt, like being a brand. I wanted to be on the Bones Brigade with my friends and peers, but I knew that in the products I have now, I think I make more of a living and blessed to be able to make a living is off the graphics. After I started writing for Powell, that's really, you know, because I had one graphic on Powell.
Right.
You know, and it's still, and they're so nice to let me use the graphic. They've been producing it for the last 13 years.
13 years, yes.
You know, so I'm like, all these beautiful colorways. I love George Powell, Stacy. I don't have any bad feelings toward any of them at all. You know, it's more I thank them and appreciate the opportunity they gave me. So it's really more positive. It isn't like I don't have any hate towards them.
I mean, you see, what you're displaying, you know, is something that's already in our nature. You know, it's the righteousness. So I see that you looking at it for, you know, what we would say is the best part. You're looking at the aspect of the positive things that you got from the experience.
Oh, yeah. It was the best experience in skateboarding to be on the Bones Brigade. So that was...
Yeah, well, let me just, if I may, I'd like to fill in the viewers, you know, because, you know, of course you are part of the legendary Bones Brigade, but, you know, as pioneers do, they always start new trends. And, you know, before Rodney Mullen co-founded World's Industries and before Danny Way began DC, you know, it was this gentleman right here who paved the way to start your own brand, Mr. Steve Steadham. So, you know, I want to definitely give you your flowers in that regard as well, because, you know, at that time, that, what is it, 86 going into 87 maybe, it was probably unheard of to start your own skateboard brand, but especially after leaving, you know, Powell Peralta in the Bones Brigade. But 30 well, plus years Alva now.
Tony Alva did it, you know, but I was never thinking about starting no company. I felt like I was forced to. But no, people weren't running a company and being a top skater. You can't run a company and be a top skater. Mm-hmm. That's part of my demise as far as being a top competition skater, because it was competition that dictated the Bones Brigade. We did well in contests. We didn't do right. Got video parts in one or two video sessions, and that was it. We didn't go back a month later to do one trick, like, you know, street skating, they take a year to shoot a video. It was literally, you do your run right now in this contest, and that's, you're either top skater or you're not, because even if you skate really good and fall in the contest, you're not considered a top skater. You got to stay on under pressure consistently. Right. Which I wish it would sort of come back, because it was epitome of professional anything. You know what I mean? Like, you got to do right. it right now, not compile it over time.
Right.
You know, but it's, I know it's changed.
Yeah.
Internet. We didn't have the internet. So
no, we didn't. No YouTube, no IG how-tos, no nothing. It was either, you know, VHS tapes from your friends, or you would wait on a monthly magazine from Thrasher or Transworld. So yeah. That's literally what we had.
Computer, so it was pretty primitive.
Yes. No pun intended. Yeah. All right. So, you know, let's fast forward, because, you know, you've been skating and playing music for over three plus decades. You know what I'm saying? And another accomplishment that was brought into existence was the pioneering and organizing and the producing of ESPN's Legend of the Vert for X Games.
Yeah.
And then the Masters of the Vert in Street for the Maloof Money Cups. I had no idea when I was doing my research, Steve. So please tell me how did those opportunities come to fruition?
Well, first thing I got to say, once again, is Jesus Christ loves me. I'll tell you the truth, because I don't know how some of this stuff happens. The X Games happened. I quit skating, and then I was at the fans contest talking to some guy in the restaurant, you know, where they're doing the writers meeting and all this stuff. Some guy started talking to me for like 45 minutes. We're just talking and just talking. And then he's like, yeah, so yeah, we've been wanting to have the Legends in the X Games. So yeah, that'd be cool if you did it. And I'm looking at him like, huh? What are you talking about? Because I wasn't trying to produce anything. Right. He's like, you're the right person to do it. Our whole video crew grew up on you guys. And wow. I didn't even have a name. I was just talking to him for a while.
Okay.
And then, like, oh, okay. Well, who do I talk to about that? And he's like, oh, me. I'm the lead producer of ESPN. I'm the one that decides everything, from car races to everything. And I was looking at him like, are you kidding me? He's like, I was talking to the main guy for 45 minutes, and I didn't even know who he was.
Wow.
He just found out my mindset. I'm old school. I'm just more, I think I'm a fair person. Of course, you know, I don't care about politics. It doesn't matter who you ride for.
Right.
You skate the best. I'm like, hey, that person should win, you know. And he's like, you're the right person to do the event. And he gave me full control over the Legends of Vert and the Legends of Street for the X Games. And I was like, I didn't even understand the magnitude of that. He's like, whatever you want to do, the sponsors talk to you, they pay you, you pay the riders, we don't have nothing to do with you. And I'm looking at him like, what? And then I went to the ESPN office in LA and talked with him, and he was straight up legit. He's like, no, you're the right person to produce this event. And I got all the riders to do it. Tony Hawk skated, which was a blessing. And
wow.
got sponsors. I think everyone I paid everyone like $500 for like 4 or 5 runs, because it's all we had each was 4 runs, 5 runs. And it was just an amazing event. It went out really smooth. And then we did it. I did it the next year. He thought I did a good job, and I produced the next year.
Wow.
And then it became a Next Games event for the next 4 or 5 years. So then I was just skating in the event. It became an actual X Games event because they were selling out, you know, before they, all the people wanted to see the legends skate, which I was like, wow.
Yes.
We skated before the vert contest, and then and it was packed. They're like, oh my gosh, there's, it was already packed. And so they were like, so that happened. And then the Maloof Money Cut people, they heard that I did the legends thing, and they're like, hey, maybe you could do some, do the legends thing, for our event. And I did the Masters of Vert, is what I called that, the Masters of the Street for Maloof, which was the same concept. And that extended into the Maloof Money Cup. And then I did that for a couple of years.
Wow.
So it was just a blessing, you know what I mean? Like, you know, everyone was part of it. It was all positive. I was just skating with old good friends. And, you know, I have a love for all those guys, you know. Lance, MCGILL. I just love MCGILL. He's been my favorite forever. He's the nicest guy. And he was like the guy in the Bones Brigade that I always felt connected with.
Out of the whole Bones Brigade.
Yeah, I mean, Lance was like my friend, you know what I mean? But I don't know what
it was. Because of the Whittier.
It's just like he was just, I rode his board before I was amateur, when I was amateur before I turned pro. And I think he liked that, but he was always nice to me. I mean, the whole Bones Brigade was all nice, though. I'm, you know, like they were never, but just MCGILL was always the person that I was happy to be on the Bones Brigade because of him. You know, but they were all the best skaters. But that's how the Maloof Money Cup and the X Games things happened. Not to go off into a tangent into something else, but and that was one of the best things, because again, so many people love seeing the legends skate on the, and we had to skate on a vert ramp. You know, we wanted to skate a pool, but they're like, "Hey, all we have is a vert ramp, so you're gonna have to skate on the vert ramp or not do it." And I'm like, "Shoot, we're gonna do it on whatever."
Right.
So we need to get back into X Games, actually.
That's awesome, Steve. You know, from the sounds of it, you know, you're having a blessed career, you know, to still be in this thing and be so influential, you know, to what's going on now. You know, I want to shift a little bit into the music side of things, because, you know, I know that's a love of yours. You know, what kind of bands do you feel have influenced you musically, and is that the kind of brand of music that you, you know, branched out into and wanted to branch out into?
Well, I listen to a lot of music, but I heard Tom Sawyer from Rush, and then that, for the after the first 14 bars, I was going to play the drums because I heard that song. I didn't even know who it was yet until they announced it. It just came on the radio. But Bad Brains, Rush, James Brown, Michael, Bob Marley, Steel Pulse, Third World.
Yes.
Those are the bands that really inspired me. I like punk and stuff, but not as much. Bad Brains was ahead of, they're still ahead of their time.
Right? Yeah, they're still ahead of their time, yes.
They're insane, yeah. So, but those are the main four bands. Queen, Earth, Wind & Fire, those are the groups that inspired me pretty much musically.
Wow. So yeah. you mentioned Steve Caballero as being like one of your favorites of all time, or like hero status. Like, I mean, to this day, is that how you still feel about Steve?
Well, I think he's pretty much the epitome of a skateboarder.
Mm-hmm.
I really think Caballero, I mean, Christian Osoy is pretty much, I think I was inspired by him the most.
Another legend. Oh, my goodness.
You know, I mean, he was so underrated, got dogged in the contests. He won half of those contests. But Caballero, street style, he would learn and skate. Vert ramp, he would learn and skate.
Yes.
Pole skating, he would learn and skate. Anything he wanted to skate, he was a top skater at it. Like, so I think he might be one of the best skaters ever, you know, but, which is hard to, you know, but as far as skating everything and anything.
Yes.
Probably him. Last Mountain's another one.
Yes.
That's just, can just skate anything and everything. He says he doesn't skate vert that great, and he's just insane, you know. But yeah, I would still say Caballero. But Caballero, Christian, and Lance, to me, I mean, those three guys.
Those three guys.
you know, Gator was good as far as pool skating and ramp skating, but yeah, but Caballero style is just so amazing.
Wow. You
know, I've always related to style
and Christmas, yes, you
know, more than tech tricks, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that's one thing I loved about your style. You were very fast. You were very powerful. But at the same time, you were just like, so you had an elegance and a smoothness and a grace about your style. So just, yeah, I can see where the influence comes from because, you know, for the people who don't know, those names, those guys that he, you know, he's mentioned from Christian Assoy, like that gentleman right there is the inventor of the Christ Air. Steve Caballero, the Caballerial, Lance Mountain, this guy, Lance Mountain, you know, besides his skating style, he's a revered artist, like literally with, you know, with the touch of his hand. So,
oh, they're all good artists. It's insane.
Yes. Yeah.
Oh, really good. I mean, which makes sense because their minds are so they're so talented, you know what I mean?
Advanced.
Yeah, they really are. They're like they're from another planet. I think all of those guys, they're a trip.
Well, so. Steve, you know, I wanted to like seriously thank you for this opportunity. I told you I wasn't gonna take a lot of your time. You know, these were just some of the questions that I wanted to ask for the 30 plus years of, you know, my life of one, you know, following skating, the sport of skating. But, you know, like I said, you were there at the beginning. You were my first inkling, you know, of what I could see of what was attainable for me as a skater coming up in that time, in that era. and I just, I thank you very much for this opportunity and for this interview and just for your time and everything that you have contributed to the sport and beyond.
I really
hope that people, you know, see this interview and they share it and it gets in the right hands and you know, the right people get to see it and get to know that, you know, Steve Steadham is out here. He's still flourishing in the skate world, you know, beautifully. And I think he just, you know, definitely needs his flowers and more recognition, and I'm glad I'm one of the first to do so.
Well, I appreciate it. I am working on a book, so that'll be out pretty, but in a minute though, it'll be probably by Christmas. But I do have a shoe brand, and I want to.
Yeah, let's talk about it. Just tell the people what you got.
Big shoes. I got some killer boots.
All right.
So I got a lot of shoes. Third World has been really nice. The last one I'm going to show you guys is this one, a canvas.
Oh, wow.
Group. So I've been working with them. I've been coming up with a lot of products and just been blessed to build my brand. So hopefully some of those viewers out there will look into it and get something.
Well, you know, with that smile on your face, you know, and a smile on my face, I have a feeling that you and I and a couple of people that are in here are going to be, you know, collaborating very, very soon.
I hope so. I got a guy named Keith Hohen who bought a great guy, collector, became friends with him, and he I started some guitars. I went crazy on products. I got a guitar brand now.
Yes.
A lot of my new guitars, they came out super nice. So I just thought I'd mention that, you know, music and skateboarding, I'm sort of trying to bring it together.
Yeah, they go hand in hand.
What's that?
Yeah, I said, yeah, they go hand in hand.
Yeah.
Wow, Steve, man. Again, thank you so much for joining us on Choppin' It Up with the Conduit. This is an awesome season finale. Childhood dream of mine come true to actually, you know, interview you, but more so become friends. And I'm literally going to be picking your brain some more because, you know, the names you've mentioned and, you know, these are guys that you've got to compete with and got to skate with and, you know, just grow in the sport every day. Like, this is just an amazing night for me. And I want to thank you again.
That's good. You're so welcome. Thank you. Thank you.
All right, man. I won't hold you up. I'll let you get back to handling the business. Before you go, why don't you tell the people how they can reach you and how they can support you and, you know, get in touch and follow Steve and find out what you're into.
Well, my website is www.stedhams.us, S-T-E-D-M-Z. And, or just send me a message on Facebook. You know, I get a lot of messages and stuff. There's a lot of, some drama on there. There's a lot of retarded people, but I don't, that comes with the territory, so it's sort of humorous. But, you know, people just message me or go to my website. A lot of my new products aren't on my website yet.
Okay.
But there's a lot of products on there, though. But I have a lot of new products, from energy drinks to, I don't know if you can see that.
Yeah, that's, I can see that. And that's the classic design, the graphic.
Yeah, the bomber graphics.
Yes.
You know, so I just been, you know, guitars, music, skateboarding, shoes. I got some backpacks coming out, iPhone cases, freaking floor mats. I sent you a bunch of images and stuff. Shower curtains.
Yes, yeah, I've seen it all. We're definitely going to talk, Steve.
Some Kona coffee, you know, for the coffee guys. It's all Hawaiian coffee. It's just been a long journey. But, yeah, that's what I'm doing right now. But you can, my viewers that are out there and your viewers, if you want to check anything out, just go to that website or just send me a message. But I'm around, you know. Pretty busy, but I'm around.
All right. Well, I'm glad you're around. And, again, I thank you for joining us tonight, legend. Yeah. Living legend, Steve Steadham. Pioneer, revolutionary musician. Oh man, starter, beginner of it all, man. Again, thank you for joining us, Steve, and we'll definitely be in touch soon.
All right, man. No man. God bless, man.
Well, I guess he's out.
All right, peace.
All right, peace out.
All right.
All right. You can just hit the X. Yeah, there you go. All right. All right, y'all. That was the legendary pioneer, Steve Steadham, formerly of POWELL PERALTA and member of the legendary Bones Brigade. This was our season finale of season 4. I thank y'all for joining us, man, this season. It was a nice mix of guests. But, you know, not to be biased, but this one was very special to me because, you know, in the world of skating, you know, coming up in the late 80s and 90s, there wasn't much representation, like I said. And, you know, being able to see Steve Steadham and watch him, you know, it actually, you know, pushed me to end up seeing other greats in the sport, such as Ray Barbie and your Stevie Williams and Clyde Singletons and Chuck Treese's of the game, Kareem Campbell's, Nigel Houston's. I mean, the list goes on and on. You know, to where, you know, now the sport is dominated as such. This will be up for those who asked. I'm definitely about to repost this. But also, you know, subscribe to podcasts on Vivo and subscribe to our SoundCloud and Audio Mac, Spotify and Apple Podcasts. It's Choppin It Up with the Conduit. And that's Choppin' with an N, no G. And that's with, that's a W with a slash. So, you know, make sure you tell your friends, tell a friend, share, rate, comment. But make sure you subscribe, hit that subscribe button, man. And we'll make sure we keep bringing you some awesome interviews. Again, thank y'all for joining us for season 4. This was our season finale. And super special thanks to our guest, Steve Steadham, pioneer skateboarding. Man, wow, this was a dream come true. Again, we'll see y'all soon. Seasons 1, 2, 3 is already out. Season 4 is already up. This is the last one. Make sure y'all support. Until then, y'all be safe and y'all be good to each other. Peace.